Good morning. Today, for a change, we take a break from solidarity, social credit, the NDP, and the rest of them. I don't think it's time yet to count the dead and the wounded on the battlefield. It may well be that Jack Monroe's neck is on the chopping block if he can't deliver the proper avenues of consultation with Premier Bennett on the social issues and the other aspects which brought thousands of people out onto the streets of Vancouver in a most unexpected protest and show of labor power in the streets. It may well be that Premier Bennett's package of his bills is still totally in place, but some moves have been made. The threat of a general strike has been lifted from the province of British Columbia, and that's got to be good. The BCGEU are apparently reasonably happy at the moment with their proposed contract hammered out over that lengthy bargaining. Everybody else who was or were on legal or illegal strikes are back to work for the moment. So maybe now's the time until something else happens to cool it, let the dust settle, and see if the avenues of consultation and the proposed mediation between solidarity and the government and between the individual unions and their exemptions under the hated Bill 3, see if they work. So instead this morning, we're going to give you very much a change of pace. To begin with, who is this man? And what is he doing in this old film clip? You see it? I don't know what he's drinking. I don't think he'd do it again today, but he's drinking it whatever. And then, in a moment, he gives us another somewhat incredible demonstration. Never having been to university, I don't know what he's doing. But here he is again, going into his act. Anything for showbiz, you might think, on this particular occasion. Not content with this particular demonstration, he now reappears from the fishies in what looks like a miniature submarine. The man, of course, is the estimable Dr. Gordon Shrum. What were you drinking in that first clip?
The first one, it was 2,4-D. I'm not certain whether it was, I did it twice on successive days. One, the first one was 2,4-D, and then they said, well, you'd be afraid to drink 2,4-5-T. That's the yellow, the orange, you know. No, I said to the fellow with me, would you be, he was a chemist, would you drink that? He said, yes, so I said I would. So the second day, we drank a glass of that.
And then, what about all that, the snowy stuff, the fog on the ground? What was
oh,
that?
Oh, that's liquid air. Drinking liquid air.
Good for you, does it?
It's kept me pretty good health to my present age. I think drinking those things kind of sterilized my interior, you know, and that's the reason I've been so healthy. Keep my fingers crossed.
But you don't take a little shot every morning when you get up?
No, I don't do that.
And that funny little submarine, that's a number of years ago. Whose submarine was that?
Oh, I don't know. It was made here in Vancouver. They sold them to the Russians. And there was some reluctance to sell them to the Russians because they considered that they had some technology, high tech, that belonged to the Americans built into this. There was quite a dispute about it. I don't know all the details. I think they built two or three. And I guess they sold them. The company went bankrupt. They didn't. You couldn't build enough of them to
now,
make money.
You're here for a very special occasion this morning, Dr. Gordon M. Shrum, because plans are afoot to endow a million dollar endowment fund for a chair in science at Simon Fraser University, which you built on a blank check from W.A.C. Bennett. And we have a little bit of This Is Your Life, Gordon Shrum. Later in the program, we're going to talk to a guy who became an anti-commie after being a commie at Cambridge. His name is H.S. Ferns. But down to business with my chum Shrum. On November the 19th at the Bay Shore, there's going to be a $200 plate dinner Only cost you $2,000 for a table for you and nine of your friends. And it's a very good object. It's to raise $1 million for a goddamn Shrum chair in science, an endowment fund. Now, why would anyone want to honor Gordon Shrum? I've gone briefly through some things this incredible man has done through the years. And just off the top, don't forget that one. He was once the president and chief executive officer of an organization now long forgotten called the BC Electric. And then he became chairman of the BC Hydro and Power Authority. He was also chairman of the BC Energy Board. He was an important part of the Atomic Energy Commission of Canada. He was the director of the BC Buildings Corporation. He was chairman of the Project for Peer BC Development. He, in fact, and I should throw this in, was the man in charge of building the Peace River dams. He was the man who rescued, and I think that's the right word, Robson Square. He built the museum and the planetarium, and goodness knows what else he hasn't done. He was an important member of the Glasgow Royal Commission and Government Organization, Royal Commission and BC Power. He was a soldier, a physicist, and he makes his own jam. So before we ask Gordon Shrum to say a single word, Steve Wyatt, my intrepid production co-producer, has slapped together some bits and pieces on which I shall try with Gordon's help to give you the voiceover. Here is Gordon Shrum as a 20-year-old soldier in the First World War, correct?
Correct.
Here is Gordon Shrum at the time when he graduated from the University of Toronto in 1920, what? 1920. Here he is, circled in his appointment to the physics department at UBC. Here he is, the terror of the OTC at UBC. He was, too. Here, next we will see Shrum's slum, the establishment of Acadia Camp and at the University of BC. Here, of course, we see some more of Acadia Camp. And then I think we'll see the transplanted barracks which were brought in barges from somewhere. Come on.
Tofino on the west coast of Vancouver.
Are these the ones brought from Tofino on the west coast, right?
I think those came from New Westminster.
Oh, they were stolen from New Westminster, as I recall, one way or another.
Yeah.
And UBC had gone from 2,500 to 10,000 in a flash after the war. What are you doing there?
I don't know.
You're acting as a booster for the UBC Thunderbirds. Yeah. This was a moment in time when they were digging the first sod for that, which of course is Simon Fraser University. And at that particular time, or around that time, there you are with Premier W.A.C. Bennett, the man who trusted you with the whole wide world. And on his death, you said this about W.A.C.
The relationship with Mr. Bennett was based on implicit confidence he had in me. And because he trusted me so implicitly, I worked awfully hard not to betray that trust. You'd be surprised, the reaction on a person when you expected to do something and the person in charge has such confidence that you will do it properly. Simon Fraser University, he never even told me how much money I could spend. He just said, go and build a university. The only thing that was difficult, he said, have it open in September 65. And this was in May 63.
And there, of course, is Simon Fraser coming towards its completion. No more blank checks nowadays, I'll tell you. The next one into which Gordon Shrum was called, oh no, here was when he was really in charge of building one of the greatest projects, largest projects in the history of Canada. And that's the opening of the Peace River Dam. And I think that's a Governor General, Lieutenant Governor Perks. And then he was called in to rescue, and that's the word. Robson Square, which had gone through many changes and many stages of change in its developments.
One can't be very popular if one is pushing people around and insisting upon meeting deadlines and so forth. So I guess that's the only contribution that I have made, is to not have to worry about my popularity.
And I don't think you ever have worried about your popularity.
No, I never set out for that.
Yet, you were not a man who laid about in public with a claymore, except when you had to. Is that not correct?
Just a few people that were incompetent, and I happened to get them by mistake or something, you know.
On the Peace River Dam, I'd forgotten that you actually ran the BC Electric at the time of the plan. Was this after the plan to take it over, but when in fact it was sold to the government by the BC Electric?
I recommended to Mr. Bennett, I told him he had to take over the BC Electric if he wanted to build a Peace River Dam, because you couldn't build a dam without a market for the power. And the BC Electric people were unwilling to give a commitment that they would buy the power. And no person in his right mind would build a very, very large power project if it had no market. So he had to take over the BC Electric, and he paid them well for it.
The Columbia River was already on the way at that time?
No, it was not. This was, they were still arguing about the Columbia River. The federal government didn't want the Peace River built. They wanted to put everything on the Columbia. And I had to do a little reconciliation there between these two. So I recommend we do both at the same time, simultaneously. And most experts, now experts are usually wrong. That's one thing you can be certain. If you're on the opposite side of the experts, you're probably right. But in any case, the experts said that one would be too big. BC couldn't absorb all the power from one of those projects, let alone both of them. Well, I recommended Mr. Bennett, I was chairman of the Energy Board then, that he do both. And then we'd satisfy the federal government, and we would satisfy Mr. Bennett. Mr. Bennett had a vision of the North. He had advantage over John Diefenbaker. John Diefenbaker also had a vision of the North, but it was too far north.
He wanted blacktop from igloo to igloo. Yeah. That was the Diefenbaker vision.
Yeah, but Mr. Bennett only wanted to go north in British Columbia, up just beyond the center of British Columbia.
Mind you, you and I will remember some of the hysterical times we had earlier on when a man called Werner Gren came in and planned to have ore trains running up and down the mountainsides at 200 miles an hour, remember?
Through the Rocky Mountain Trench, yeah.
Through the Rocky Mountain Trench.
Yeah, monorail, the monorail.
And yeah, but incredible speeds there were going to be.
Yeah.
But was that the time that Bennett realized that the Rocky Mountain Trench had to be used instead of for mining, for dams?
Well, that was at the same time that the difficulty is that Werner Gren didn't find any minerals in the Rocky Mountain Trench to supply his railroad. And the only thing that came out of it was that this was a very, very good, very attractive power project.
And is it good, Dr. Shrum, scientist and every man's expert? I got to call you an expert. Is it good that today we're now selling power, our surplus power, on a long-range basis to places in California?
Well, look, Jack, we're fighting to sell natural gas to to California, and natural gas is a resource that's being depleted, and we sell it. It's a valuable source of energy. Hydroelectric power is renewable. It goes on forever, as long as the sun shines. It's just plain stupid of the Canadian people generally that they're not prepared to sell any kind of electric, surplus electric power to the Americans if they can get a market.
Renewable power.
Especially renewable, I mean. But we sell coal. Coal is a
non-renewable resource.
Non-renewable resource. It's exhaustible. We're fighting to sell it, to get money for it. Why wouldn't we sell electric power?
Later on, I'm going to ask you about, we're going to show a clip and ask you if you are still of the same opinion on a certain delicate, sensitive subject with which you disagreed with W.A.C. Bennett. But this is a fair...
Well, I was right, and so I can tell you, whatever it was, I was always right. And he recognized this, and so I can tell you before he asked me, I still know it's correct.
You were to bring me a jar of jam this morning.
I forgot. I'll come some the next time. What do you like, citron or... quince or raspberry or what?
Raspberry's safer, I think, especially if you're making it after the break.
And I still think that when the time comes, they won't find any other solution but nuclear power that will be acceptable to environmentalists and ecologists and economists and so on. It will be the cheapest, safest, and the cleanest generation that will be available, and this will be proved in the next 2 years. I don't think there's any argument about it.
Among other things, Dr. Gardner Shrum, who denies he is an expert, but merely a man of common sense. Common sense and vision.
Common sense, yeah.
What about your vision that nuclear power is the only possible safe future source of energy and an absolute must for the world today?
I still believe it. I know that's right. Now, let me not be misunderstood. I'm concerned as anybody. I'm just as frightened as anybody about a nuclear war. I don't want to get nuclear war mixed up with nuclear power. Those are two different things. And we have no other source of energy in sight for the world's population other than nuclear power. And most countries are recognizing this. They run into difficulties, all kinds of difficulties. But if it's the only solution, you have to solve those difficulties. And if I were in charge, the first thing I would do, I would spend a tremendous amount of money convincing people that nuclear power is safe and demonstrating to them that it's safe, and then get on with it, because we no use going on using up. Maybe in my lifetime I will see the oil exhausted, the world's supply of oil. Well, if you took the energy that we get from oil today and subtract that from our economy, I don't know what would happen. It would be a tremendous crisis. It would be a disaster.
Is there any? I remember coming out to see you 30 years ago, 25 years ago, doing little taped interviews with you on the strontium 90 in the atmosphere. Remember those days?
Oh, yes, yes.
You were the living expert, like a lumper, on any scientific expert when you ran the physics department at UBC, right? Now, have you measured strontium 90 lately? Or
not for a long time, but I used to measure the fallout. It was a good place to do it in Vancouver, because the rain is a great sweeper. The rain brings the stuff out of the atmosphere. That's the reason we never have any bad incidents of flu or anything when it's raining all the time. It's only when we get a dry spell in the winter that we run into it. So this rain would bring, when the Russians were exploding their nuclear bombs, hydro bombs and so on, it would come over here and the rain would bring it down. We'd measure how much we'd get.
You're now 80, forget the subject, I'm bored with that now. You're now 87 years of age.
That's right. I'll soon be 88. Soon be in what they call my 89th year, really. You know.
Are you big in physical exercise?
Reasonably. I do a lot of walking, a lot of exercise in the garden, and a tiny little bit of jogging, you know.
Oh, come off it. You're not still jogging, are you?
Well, the difficulty is the bus boys, they seem to know me, and they see me jogging. They think I'm in a hurry, and they stop the bus and say, get on.
You're now going to meet some of your friends, some of your good friends. And the first one we're going to see now is a fellow whom you'll recognize instantly, because it's none other than one of your former students by the name of Bob Bunner.
I thought I knew him better by saying that he was accountable for a good deal of successful recruiting by the Navy and the Air Force, because he terrorized so many people out of the Army. He was a formidable commanding officer. Apart from being competent, he could dominate a parade square of about 2,000 other ranks and officers with just a raise of an eyebrow and a bark of a command. And I think for us who were transformed from civilians into something else in that period, he was the first taste of Army discipline we had, and an excellent model, really, as an officer and a gentleman.
That was when you were commanding officer of the Officers Training Corps at
World War II.
World War II. You had won the military medal, said Webster. This is your life.
That was back in World War I.
World War
I. Yes.
When you were in the Royal Canadian Artillery.
That's right.
That was Bonner. He was one of your students.
Yes.
And later succeeded you as.
He succeeded me as colonel in the COTC.
And later succeeded
me
you.
At Hydro, too.
At Hydro.
Yes.
Don't I remember?
Well, Cass Begg succeeded me, Bonner, but he. He was the next one after Cass.
Cass who? Cass Begg. Well, I remember you were complaining to me before the program you pointed out that I objected publicly to your exorbitant salary when you ran the BC.
When I was appointed, yeah.
What was your salary?
$40,000 a year. And it stayed at that. For the 12 years I was at Hydro, Mr. Bennett would never increase my salary. He always thought so long as I was getting more than Gallardi, there was no reason why I should have my salary increased.
And you did the negotiations with the union in those days, as I recall.
Yes, I had great success dealing with the unions because I could talk their language. I tell them when they come in, now you want to use tough language, all right. I had over 3 years in the Army and the ranks, and let's have a little shouting match if you want it. But I got along fine with them. My door was always open for the union people.
Good. Here is another friend of yours, a very distinguished citizen of British Columbia, the Chief Justice of British Columbia, another of your students, was he not?
Oh, yeah.
Nathan Nemetz.
Well, first of all, I'm indebted to Mr. Webster for suggesting that I say a few words about my old friend, Gordon Shrum. And you'll recall, Gordon, that as I said to you the other day at the convocation in this great hall of our courthouse, if it weren't for you, we wouldn't have had this courthouse. It nearly, the government had almost decided to abandon it after 20 years. And here we are in my chambers of Chief Justice discussing this very place, which you are greatly responsible for having expedited and having completed in due course. And the other thing, of course, that comes to my mind is, I was once your student, you recall, and that during your lectures, you expounded to us not only the Newtonian theory of physics, but also in those days, which was new for our jurisdiction, the question of Einstein and all his matters that he drew up. But I think that perhaps the greatest thing is I recall the quip that you made to me on your 85th birthday when I asked you how you're feeling, and you said to me, when I think of the alternative, I feel fine.
That's a good stock answer. Yeah. The alternative is not really that pleasant. You were involved deeply in the arts and culture, I found to my astonishment. I knew you'd built all these planetariums and museums and whatnot. But here is a woman, a very distinguished woman, who gives you a lot of credit for getting the artistic movement underway in the city, in British Columbia in many ways, because it happened at UBC.
Lots of people helped. But there was the president, it was the golden age of the arts at the university. And there was Gordon Shrum with his mighty strength, his energy, and his imagination, who started it. And all the credit growth came out of what he did in the extension department.
Dorothy Somerset.
Yes, I was forced to do it. You see, I was a scientist. And everybody felt when I took over the extension department, it was all concentrated on science. And I wanted to demonstrate that that wasn't true. And it's true. I appointed the first professor of theater at UBC.
Well, you've always been a bit of a ham yourself.
That's right.
You must admit. Is that not correct? Next, a political woman with whom you worked closely and caused many a spark on many an issue. And we don't have to introduce this particular member of the BC cabinet.
I recall when I first asked him to work on the Trade and Convention Center for the province of British Columbia. I said, Dr. Shrum, we want to build a trade and convention center, and I need somebody like you to make sure that it gets done. He said, you know, Grace, if it can get done, let me see, in the next 10 years, he said, I'm with you. I'd be glad to do it. He was about 80 years at the time. And I've never met a more vital, more inspiring person than Dr. Shrum.
Well, I can say I enjoyed working with Ms. McCarthy. She's a wonderful person, lots of imagination. This is what I like, people with imagination, initiative, and she's good.
Now, you put a well-known British Columbia citizen into an unlicensed, illegal business on which he financed his university education and with where he and his wife lived. You may recall that.
Yes, I know.
Let's see him.
Yeah.
I came to see you one afternoon. We talked for a few minutes. And I said, what about a coffee shop or a canteen for the students you're bringing in? And you said, that's a good idea. Come back tomorrow morning and give us your plans for it. Well, my wife and I had never designed anything like that before in our lives. We sat up half the night and drew up plans for a canteen and a two-bedroom house for ourselves in the hut, put it all together. At 9 o'clock the next morning, I was in your office. We talked for another 15 minutes, and it was done, and that was it. And I'll never forget the speed and enthusiasm with which you greeted those ideas, and we got them done. I wish we could still do things like that.
Well, the important thing is, if one's going to make a decision, make it promptly. Get all the information one can get, in a reasonable time and then make the decisions. Better to have a bad decision than no decision at all.
Tell me a bit about Shrum's slum.
I got into that by accident. I had built the army with the students' wage pay. Thousands of dollars we built into that army. When the war was over, it was obvious that we didn't have the facilities for the returning veterans. So the dean of engineering, he said, we'll take the armory and cut it up into classrooms and so on. Well, I didn't want to see this, and I thought a good deal about it. He was a powerful fellow, and I was only a professor. And then I thought about these beautiful huts down in what they call Little Australia in the University Endowment Lands, quite close. Big lock stave huts, thick cedar. So I started to figure out how much it would cost to move those to campus and make them into lecture rooms that he was going to make in the armory. I found I could get more lecture rooms at less money, and we'd still have the armory. So I brought in the first 13 huts or whatever it was. That was only the beginning. I think we had 1,000 huts eventually. They brought them from everywhere. The west coast of Tofino on the west coast.
Were they all old army huts?
Old army huts. And some of them are still there and doing very useful, serving very useful purposes.
Good. More with Dr. Gordon Shrum, about to be honored with an endowment chair and the Gordon M. Shrum Chair in Science after the break. I remember when you took over the Robson Square problem. At that particular time, there had been changes in design. There was great worry about escalating costs. And people like myself were freely predicting that the costs, instead of the $55 million Bennett planned for it, the old man, was going to be $250 million. Mm-hmm. And I remember you dressing me down on that when you took over.
Oh, I don't remember that.
When did you step into that one?
Oh, golly, that's difficult. It was 1976, I believe, in June or so, 1976. I think.
That was a tough job because you had to keep the cost to how much?
Well, it turned out to about 130 million, I think.
130, that's what we argued about. I said 160, of course, just to provoke you.
Yeah.
And you insisted in 130, and of course,
It was 160 when I took over, but we got it. We were able to cut back on not on the facilities in any way.
Are you a Democrat when you're running a project, Dr. Gordon Shrum, or are you a dictator?
I guess I have to be both at different times. I'm a great man to delegate authority, but if I delegate it and I make a mistake, I very quickly change it. To cut it out.
Good. Now, here is a good friend of yours.
Yeah.
Who was involved very deeply indeed in Robson Square. There he is.
I remember my first recollections of him were really in the Army when he was my colonel. And I guess my experience of him then was of sheer terror because he was a very imperious colonel. But actually, at the same time, he was my physics teacher, and I do remember being in one class where he was demonstrating with gases or something, and the experiment completely flopped. It didn't work at all. And he just stood up and said, look, if you want to get through this course, just realize that this experiment did work.
That's rather a good story from Arthur Erickson, Jr. And then in the course of our detailed research this morning, I nearly fell over backwards when I was informed that you, of all people, make your own preserves. And that information came from someone, Gordon Shrum, very close to you indeed.
Oh.
Dad, I thought I'd just take this opportunity to thank you for bringing the preserves over to me the other night. It reminded me that you're still doing all the wholesale operations in connection with agriculture that you always did at home. And it gave me the idea that perhaps this is a side of you that I could reveal without ruining your career at this stage.
Fair enough. How long have you been making preserves, Dr.
Robinson? Long time. Years.
Is it a fact that you are, in truth, a frustrated farmer?
I think there could be some truth in that. There are many careers I would like to have had. I'm sorry that I've only had three or four. What? Farming would be one. I would like to have been a farmer. I would like to have been, some of these I've been able to achieve after I retired, like take part in business or something of that sort. I enjoy it teaching. And I could have been very successful, too, as a full-time research man.
Yeah.
Research. I had some good experience, and good luck. I've had an awful lot of good luck in my life, Jack. And I've had good luck in having people like Dave Brousson come along with a bright idea. I pick it up and develop four trailer camps from his one idea. He came in there with a trailer and didn't know where to put it.
Now, talking about your scientific achievements, you were very critical indeed in advance of a certain project at the University of British Columbia. And I have that word from the man who did certain things at UBC. And once you kind of straightened away all the criticism, it became a great success indeed.
Gordon, you've been of immense help to TRIUMF. First of all, 30 years ago, you brought together here in Western Canada the first team that really pursued subatomic physics in Canada. Next, 15 years ago, when we thought we were onto a major idea to lead the world in new fields of science, you were our first and greatest critic. After we convinced you that we were onto a good thing, you opened all kinds of doors for us and provided encouragement for us, and I think you've been one of our greatest fans. I think what we've done here has provided you a great deal of pleasure.
He's a good man.
TRIUMF. TRIUMF, obviously, is for the peaceful research and the use of atomic
particles. Well, atomic particles, it has great applications in medicine, but really I think it was built for scientific purposes. We want to find more about the fundamental building blocks of matter. Mm-hmm. It's an aside, you might say, a byproduct. Fallout is the medical applications where they can get some of these particles and put them in to treat malignant tumors and so on.
You joined the Army when, how old were you, 20, 19?
Oh, I was 20, I guess, 16, 20, yeah.
So you've been working pretty steadily now for something like 67 years.
That's right.
Have you any new projects on the drawing boards at this particular moment?
Not really, no.
You must be, of course, the academic community is going to honor you with your dinner on November the 19th at the Westin Bayshore to raise the money for the endowment for the Gordon M. Shrum Chair in Science. And I think on behalf of a lot of ordinary people, not academics, we can say that you are inestimably respected in this community.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to go to the phones now. Let's take some phone calls.
Oh, I see.
Let's show them the old troublesome Shrum after the break. Pat, throw up the slide for the details of the testimonial dinner for Dr. Shrum. Gordon M. Shrum, Chair in Science, Simon Fraser University. For tickets and whatnot, phone SFU, 291-4679 or 291-3592. Now we'll go to the phones. Go ahead to Dr. Shrum.
Dr. Shrum, you're looking marvelous.
Thank you.
One of the great people that I taught. This is a gentleman whom, when my physics classes and my early engineering classes, Dr. Shrum was there, and I taught him everything I know, and he's done remarkably well since then.
Who are you?
Art Finley.
Who is it?
This is Art Finley.
Hello, Art.
Hello, Jack. How are you?
Art Finley.
Oh, Art Finley. Oh, yeah.
Dr. Shrum, how are you?
Yeah, it's nice to hear you.
Thanks, Art.
Pleasure, Jack. Dr. Shrum, congratulations.
Oh, thank you very much.
Finley was always a con man.
Yeah.
Go ahead to Dr. Shrum.
Good morning. How are you?
Go ahead.
Fine, thanks.
Good.
I can't
have,
see you.
I remembered hearing about your preserves for years. I take it there was a certain labor relations manager at Hydro at one time, and you all used to go up to Wanick to a certain sheep farm, and have a great time and get together with your preserves.
And, oh, yeah. Yes, I know. Phil Barshard.
Yeah, that's right. Phil Barshard,
yeah.
Yeah, so I've heard about you for years. I'd just like to say nice to see you on TV, and you're looking well.
Thank you very much. I'm feeling well.
Sounds like a riotous weekend at a sheep farm up the valley eating preserves, eh? An orgy of...
They didn't spend all the time eating.
Go ahead, please.
Dr. Shrum, I think British Columbia look forward to you solving another great problem, and that is the fisheries. I think someone like you should step in there and help resolve that issue.
I'm not a sports fisherman, but I'd be very happy. I know the commercial people have their problems, and there are a great number of problems there.
And if somebody asked you, you'd do it.
Probably.
Are you never going to retire?
I don't see any point in it.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Dr. Shrum.
Yes.
Yes, I'd just like to ask you if your investigations into quantum mechanics and subatomic particles has affected your philosophical or spiritual view of life at all. I'll hang up now and wait for your answer. Thank you.
Well, I tell you, I don't think we have time this morning for me to expound my philosophy, but I think any scientist or anybody who feels they know what life is all about and the direction we're going and why, they're a wiser person than I am.
Fair enough. Go ahead from Victoria.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Morning.
I'd just like to ask Dr. Shrum if he has ever, or if he ever plans to in the near future, give Mr. Bill Bennett some advice on some labor counseling.
I don't normally give advice to people unless they ask for it. He asked for help in connection with Robson Square and the courthouse, and I worked hard and tried to do a good job for him.
My opinion, I think he needs some help because I don't think he's going to go through with some of the things that he's indicated he will.
Okay, sir. I don't think the garden wants to get into that level of debate at this particular moment.
I'm not much of a politician.
Go ahead from Abbotsford.
Yes, Dr. Shrum. I'm very sorry to bring this rather sour note into your very great day. But I would like to ask, when you drank 2,4-D, how much water did you drink afterwards to dilute the poison in your system? And I would ask if you would spray that substance without a mask, or if it would be dangerous to get on your skin. And the same with 2,4-5-T. I think that a great man as yourself took that particular approach to prove that that those substances were completely safe. I think perhaps they might be safe to drink, being as the liquids of your body would dilute then the poisons, but that they're actual disastrous to be absorbed into the lungs or get onto the skin.
Okay, that is your question, Dr. Shrum.
Well, all I was trying to prove was that the people up near Lillooet was saying that the spray drifting over onto the grass in the fields was killing the horses and making them ill. And since I drank something twice the concentration of what we were spraying, and I didn't just eat a little, I drank it, and I think it proved that point. Now, it doesn't prove any point about what the effect would be on pregnant women. I agree on that. So.
It was an unwise thing to do.
No, it was a wise thing to do because the people were being frightened. They were saying that a tiny little bit of spray was killing the horses, you know. It's just pure nonsense.
2,4-5-T has since been banned, I happen to know from my own agricultural background.
But we drank it and it had no serious effect. I didn't drink any water. What I used was vodka. We found that vodka was the best thing to wash out one's mouth. I didn't take anything in my stomach to counteract it, but the stuff tastes like old dirty crankcase oil. And to get that out of one's mouth, vodka turned out to be the best.
To be the best. Well, that's certainly a piece of scientific knowledge for which I've been waiting all these many years. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Dr. Shrum.
Yes.
I'm just wondering, how do you feel about the use of propane and natural gas for use in vehicles in British Columbia?
Oh, I think I shouldn't get involved in that. All I can say is I'm still using gasoline.
Well, it just seems to me that if more people were on these fuels, it would help our economy because we're a resource-based economy and because it's our fuel.
Yes.
Dr. Pat McGeer seems to think that compressed natural gas is a good idea for us.
Yeah. I think it has some possibilities, but there are disadvantages. But in any case, it's good for something like taxi drivers and so on. We're always in the city, close to a supply and so forth. But in any case, I'm not opposing it. Don't.
You drive a big car. You must drive a big car because you're a big man.
Well, I just drive a cheap car, a big cheap car.
But you couldn't get into a wee car.
No.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Doctor.
Good morning.
Pleasure to see you. We haven't met face-to-face since years ago when I chaired a thank-you dinner out at the Dauphin that the Canadian Legion gave you and President McKenzie and Dr. Black and some other notables. I have a question for you, sir.
Sure.
In regard to hydrogen. Now, it's my understanding that Dr. Melvin Kelvin, Nobel laureate in California, has developed some chloroplastic fibers with which it's possible to convert water to hydrogen and oxygen with nothing but ambient sunlight as the energy source.
I think that would be possible, but I don't think that's... You can do it on a commercial scale. That's the difficulty.
Well, if you could separate
hydrogen and oxygen on a commercial scale, economically, that would be a good idea.
What would it do?
Well, then you could put it back together again, either as an explosion or burn it and produce energy.
You mean from water?
From water.
You could separate the hydrogen and the oxygen.
And the oxygen and two gases, and then you could burn these two gases. But the point is, unless you have an economical system for separating it, where it doesn't take more energy to separate it than you get back when you put it together again. That's the problem.
That's no good, I see.
But still, these things, every scientific discovery eventually leads to some application, it seems.
Okay, what the listeners is, keep your eye on chloroplastic fibers. Is that
right?
Yeah. Did you see that one the other day, that with some guy in California has got a huge box that you put on your back and it acts as an artificial gill and you can stay underwater for unlimited periods of time.
Who wants to do that?
People like you.
No.
Scientists. Because in the human body there is still the vestigial remnants of the gill when we were sea living things.
When we were big fish.
Yeah. Take a break. More with Dr. Shrum after the break. Gordon Shrum, Dr. Gordon Shrum, with all his titles, thousands of letters after his name, has been here this morning just to tell you about the testimonial dinner on November the 19th, by which it is hoped to raise a lot of money, $200 a seat, at Western Bay Shore on the 19th for a Gordon Shrum chair in science. Is this your first chair in science?
Yes. Well, yes, it is. There was a fund of this sort back about 4 or 5 years ago to arrange an exchange professorship in my name between TRIUMF and Rehovot in Israel. Mm-hmm. And my name was used, and that is named after me.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Morning.
Dr. Shrum?
Yes?
I like the idea you said, if you have a new idea, act upon it today. And this is what nitrogen is in hydrogen to oxygen, which is in photon to proton to byproducts. But body anatomy receives the oxygen.
Oh, thank you very much indeed. That's fascinating information, is it not? Go ahead from Whitehorse.
Whitehorse.
Where are you in Whitehorse?
Good morning, Jack.
Well, do speak up.
Hello?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, Jack?
Yep.
Good morning.
Mm-hmm. Yes?
I have a question for Mr. Shrum.
Right. Ask me the question.
Okay, Mr. Shrum.
Yes?
I understand that you are in quite favor of nuclear power plants.
Yes?
Why are you
surprised?
Isn't there a lot of nuclear waste from power plants? And
if yes, the answer is yes.
Do you have an answer of how to dispose of that waste?
Yes, yes.
Well, give them the bleeding answer, will you please?
Yeah. We put it down in the Precambrian shield, where the rock hasn't been disturbed for hundreds of millions of years. And they scooped out a lot of that for mines, and they can put this waste in there, and it's 99.99% certain that it'll never be disturbed.
Are you sure?
Well, it's been gone for 100 million years without anything happening.
But once you open up the Precambrian
shield... No, it's already
shield.
Opened up. No, no. Well, in any case, don't forget. Don't worry about it.
You know, it's only got a half-life of 27,562 years.
Yes, well, I won't live that long.
Really, take a couple more calls. We've had good fun this morning. Go ahead, please.
Yes, is that me?
That's you.
Good morning, Dr. Sharma.
Good morning.
Jack, first... I'd like to say I want to issue a challenge to Dr. Shrum and then hang up and listen for his answer. When you opened your program this morning, you showed a couple of clips of Dr. Shrum sipping this and Shrimp sipping that and with no ill effects. Now, you left one out. There was an occasion some years ago where Dr. Shrum took a sip of the Fraser River and said that it was pollution-free and capable, it was suitable for drinking. And I wonder if Dr. Shrum realize the damage a person of his esteemed position has done to the environmental picture and the Fraser, the fisheries, and how he glossed
okay,
over
I've got the
question.
Request
from a fisherman a while ago to clean up or put his energies behind cleaning up the Fraser.
I think you must be mistaken. I don't recall ever having drunk any water from the Fraser.
He is mistaken because with my incredible memory, I can name the man who did it.
Yeah, it wasn't me.
It was George Mussellum.
I apologize to Dr.
It was
Shrum,
George Mussellum.
I would think I would much prefer to drink 2,4-D than water from the Fraser River. They should sell it for fertilizer.
Go ahead from Qualicum Beach.
Yes, good morning, Jack. I'd just like to say that it lightens my day when I see such intelligent men as Dr. Shrum and Dr. Julia Sumner on your show. Thank you.
Shrum and Sumner. Well, the different kinds of professors, as I recall. Julius Sumner Miller was on here the other day. Yeah, He's Professor Wonderful.
I know him. I brought him to Vancouver the first time, right back 15 years ago.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Dr. Shrum.
Good morning.
Can nuclear power plants be safe in provinces where seismic faults are suspect? And with our shortage of landfill sites, is there a practical, inexpensive way that our garbage could be converted into energy?
When I was at Hydro, we looked at this garbage conversion. Sure, it can be converted into energy, but the energy will be more expensive than what you can get it from other sources. In regard to nuclear plants, I wouldn't put a nuclear plant on top of a fault. No, I wouldn't. I don't know how dangerous it would be, but it wouldn't make any sense to put any big, expensive structure on a fault.
You're aware
I don't
of
think
the
so.
Situation with the Devil's Canyon in California.
Mm-hmm. Well, they have this one down there, but I don't think they've had any trouble.
In any case, you say that the practical benefits of nuclear power outweigh the risks involved.
Far outweigh any.
And that mankind is bound eventually to turn to nuclear power because of the shortage of fossil fuels.
Yeah. If you're worrying about risks, don't get in your car and drive because your chances of having an accident are so much higher than any other thing I can think of.
Then if you sit at home with your door closed. Dr. Shrum, it's not often I'd say this on a program, as you well know, the name of the game in the Webster Show is not to be nice to people necessarily.
I know that.
But it's been a pleasure this morning having you here in advance of your honor and I'm sure the very successful establishment of the Gordon M. Shrum Chair in Science at SFU, for which the Endowment Fund is planned and in action. My thanks to you, Dr. Shrum.
I was very nervous about coming down because I'm afraid of you.
My chum Shrum, that'll be the day. Next, a more serious interview, a man's political history, from left to right, from commie to anti-commie, it said in the Globe and Mail, after the break. H.S. Ferns is a prairie boy who went off to Cambridge in the heyday of, I suppose, the intellectual switch to Marxism at what then, I suppose, was its finest and most snobbish hour. And in a foreword to his book written by Malcolm Muggeridge, that's a foreword to Professor Ferns' book, it says here that Ferns was at Cambridge in the heyday of leftist enthusiasm, when the elitist and quasi-secret Apostles Club included members like Guy Burgess and Anthony Blunt, whose championship of the toiling masses did not preclude or restrict their proneness to snobbishness and other unpleasant things. You were at Cambridge in those dangerous days.
I was indeed.
You were, and of course I was instantly intrigued because I thought, here's a man who was one of those people who for some strange reason were so anti-imperialist that they joined the commies, and not you, but so many of them became traitors to the West during the war. What was that phenomenon caused by?
Well, I think that there was an intellectual dimension there, you know, argument about the social sciences, but much more important in the 1930s was the apprehension felt by people about, and especially young people, about the rise of fascism, the Spanish Civil War, where it looked as if a democratic government was going to be knocked off by the officers, and indeed it was knocked off by the officers. And then not only the fear of fascism, but the belief that the leaders like Daladier and Blum in France and Chamberlain in Britain were soft on this, that they were going to give way, and indeed we were right, and the French did give way very quickly.
Not to forget the Clivedon set.
Yes, that's all. Said he
talking to our generation.
Yep, that's.
I can remember myself being totally untrustworthy about the aims of the British upper classes in 1938 and 1939.
Well, that's what we shared. That was very, very, very markedly, and that was the fundamental thing in the swing towards the left in Cambridge. In the 20s, Cambridge was like any other British university, a very right-wing, rightward-looking kind of institution. But it changed in the 30s, and the great catalytic event in that was the death of John Cornford, a young, he died on his 21st birthday, fighting against the Spanish fascists. And this poet hero, you know, the Lord Byron type of figure, that changed, turned people completely around, so that becoming a member of the Cambridge University Socialist Club, which was really a front for the communists, was a very fashionable thing to do, and a very real, very center of, well, I think of the greatest of the intellectual energy of the university at that time.
Before I get down to your move from a prairie boy to being a communist, a Marxist, which was, I should imagine, unusual in your generation.
I think it was, yes, I think it was.
In the 30s. Did you ever meet Burgess or Maclean, two people whom I still, with a bitter bigotry, hate and detest and despise?
No, I never met Burgess or Maclean. In fact, my tutor used to say to me, to try and get at me, you know, later, did you know Guy Burgess? You know, and I used to say, no. And he was gone down by the time I arrived. And finally, when he said that, when I felt I was his equal, I said, do you have to reiterate this? This is the fifth time you've asked me this question, you know. And so he stopped after that.
People nagged you about it, to upset you.
Yeah.
I mean, I still haven't got over the culture shock of the way Blunt, who was another Cambridge communist, was protected by the British establishment to the extent of allowing him to be around the Queen.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, you see, the Soviet intelligence people aimed at upper middle class and upper class young men, young women too, who would become part of the establishment. That's where they wanted agents of influence. And that's how they operated.
Tell me then, a little bit about your background on the prairies, because I recall you came from a middle-class family.
Well, lower middle class, I suppose. Well, my father was a poultry farmer. I don't know how you class people class that. I suppose he was been a bricklayer and various other things.
But he was making a living at the time when people weren't making a living at all.
Yeah, as a federal civil servant, he had a secure job, yes.
Marxism. How long did it take you to become disabused of the, shall we call it Marxism or Stalinist communism?
Well, both went together, because in my experience, you see, it was being a communist and being a Marxist are one and the same thing. I was a very long time before I ever met anyone who was a Marxist who wasn't also also a communist. So they went together. There was that deviant group, the Trotskyists, but again, they were very close. They were part of the same ball of wax, so to speak.
Did the British Army Major, you met going over to London in some way, convince you that you should head in, because you weren't a communist when you left?
No.
Did that British Major convince you to go towards the Marxist philosophy?
Oh, yes. He was the man who converted me.
Army Major?
Yes, that's the strange thing about it. Major Hooper was very concerned that I should become a Marxist, but he was also very concerned that I shouldn't wear a bowler hat, because that would betray me as a Philistine.
All right. And what were his arguments in those days?
Well, he argued a bit himself, but he was armed with the Handbook of Marxism, which had just been published then. And for instance, when I got onto discussing the state as I understood it, as a result of being a laissez-faire kind of liberal, he produced Lenin, State and Revolution. He said, "Read that." Said, "Hey, well, this worked on me like a dose of salt, I suppose, because Lenin, you see, argued that once you to reach communism, the state would disappear." And I said, "Jolly good."
So there you are, a dedicated Marxist, and a devoted Marxist from, was it the middle 30s?
No, it was, I became a member of the Communist Party in January 1937. And I was that until it would be January 1940. See, I came back from Britain to North America. I was going to go to Harvard. And I had a letter of introduction from the Secretary General of the Communist Party of Great Britain to the American Party. And I had a letter of introduction. And I did deliver the letter of introduction. But they said, well, all they said to me is, well, see this guy in Boston. Well, I never went to see this guy in Boston. It's hard to believe it, but I just forgot about it. My mind was occupied with my research and the hope of getting married.
As a matter of fact, where was that letter hidden when you crossed the Atlantic?
In the lining of my hat, the very hat that the major recommended I wear.
So therefore, you obviously, some attempt must have been made at some time to involve you in the, what do you call it, apparatus.
Well, there's no doubt about that in my mind, because when the Gazenko spy scandal broke and they examined Gazenko, he said he knew me well. And they said, well, how well? And he said, well, I know from Moscow, you know, that his... And then he said, who is he? And he said, he's an engineer in Montreal. Well, I wasn't an engineer in Montreal. They got it all mixed up. But certainly there are not many people named Henry Ferns. And so I'm sure that my name was passed back to Moscow as a prospect, you know.
More with H.S. Ferns and his book, Reading from Left to Right, and we'll find out how far right he has gone now after the break. H.S. Ferns, from left to right, philosophical Marxist, never leaned on really to do anything for the party except contact them in the United States.
Yeah.
How did your career go after that when Gazenko inaccurately threw your name in? He just had been rehearsing lists of party members from Cambridge, I suppose.
Well, it had no effect, and no one ever came to question me about it. Absolutely nothing. I mean, if I made a mess of my career, I suppose it was because I took up with trying to... I had the idea of starting a third newspaper in Winnipeg, and... Well, the part of the paper did start. I mean, it was reported to me that one newspaper proprietor said, though, that I'm going to run that son of a bitch out of town. Well, of course he did.
That was the Winnipeg?
Citizen.
What year was that?
Well, I first had the idea in 46, I guess it was, when there was a strike of the ITU men in the Tribune and the Free Press. And, it was about a couple of years, 18 months of organizing, and then they did publish, you know.
It was a pretty bold step, though. Just before I ask you how far you've gone to the right, your membership in the party came back to haunt you when you applied for a job involving the National Defense Department, did it not?
Well, I'm not sure whether it did come back to haunt me. I applied for this job in good faith, partly because I wanted to live in Victoria rather than in Winnipeg, but also because I believed that I knew that I had this kind of albatross hanging around my neck.
The job was to teach at Royal Roads.
I teach at Royal Roads, and I applied in the normal way, and I said, well, now this will give the Canadian government an opportunity to look at me and if they employ me, then who can say that I'm a red? If they don't employ me, I'm no worse off than I was before.
At that time, you had left the party.
Oh, yes, I never. Well, I was never in the party in North America.
Oh, I see. Yeah. And so when you applied, they approved your job at Royal Roads, and then?
Then after we'd sold our house in Winnipeg and just about to buy a house in Victoria, I get a three-line letter saying you're unacceptable.
And that was that?
That was that, you bet.
All right. As a young man, no one can blame you for adopting the Marxist formula. It's all perfectly legal in every way, and still is to this day.
Absolutely.
What soured you? Usual? Stalinism?
Well,
the Nazi Soviet Pact?
It came in. No, the Nazi Soviet Pact didn't affect me one way or the other. In fact, I thought it only proves that they're pretty smart fellows. No, it was partly it was intellectual, some doubts about Marxism itself, it's as a set of ideas, and then things like the Yalta Agreement, as that began to come out about that, it looked like a carve-up of the world, no different than in the case of the Versailles Treaty, and I can remember, it's very odd, really, it was a very small item about Turkey in the Winnipeg Free Press that really had a very great effect on me. This was to the effect that the Soviet government had presented a note to the Turkish government saying they wanted to revise the Montreux Convention, which set the boundaries between Turkey and the Soviet Union on the grounds that this agreement was arrived at when they were weak, now they were strong. So, you see, well, I mean, this is Tsardom all over again. This is Tsarist imperialism all over again. It had an effect upon my thinking out of all proportion to the importance
but
of
I
the
But I can see the point of it. All right, today, yeah. What are you today, politically, if you can give me a philosophy? At the end of your book, what are you?
Well, the only party card I've ever carried is that of the Edgbaston Conservative Club in Birmingham. So I guess I am a Tory, but that doesn't mean very much, in as much as anybody can join the Tory party as long as they pay.
And if it says here in the dear old Toad and Flail, Henry Ferns once liked Stalin. Now he lauds Ronald Reagan's invasion of Grenada and Chile's Augusto Pinochet.
Yeah.
Is that so?
Well, that's about the agenda, about agenda's overthrow. I have some qualification about that. But about the invasion, about the knocking Castro on the head in Grenada, I'm 100% for it, and all I regret is that the British government had not taken a part in that. I don't understand how they're going to wanting to run down their forces in Belize. They should have something there, I think, and they should have had something there to prevent this sort of thing happening, because after all, Castro was building an air base there or an airport. That was about 10 times as big as the tourist requirements of the island of Grenada, with fuel tanks being installed that were for no planes that would carry tourists, but planes that would carry some other stuff.
Are you telling me, though, that you now look on Reagan the same way as you would look on Stalin or Andropov or anybody else, and that we are at the mercy power politics in their spheres of influence? You all over again.
Well, I think the spheres of influence are there, but as for 100% support for Reagan, that would be not how you would describe me at all. I think that Reagan seems to me a bit quick on the trigger. I think he does some mistaken things, like over that Korean airliner. He sounded like a mighty lion for a little while, and then when it came to a matter of doing something, he sounded like a mouse.
After you left Canada, after the war, went back to England, did
yes,
you not?
Yes, that's right, yes.
What were you doing in England?
Well, I was a teacher in the university from 1950 till I retired in Birmingham.
In
university.
Birmingham?
Yeah.
And this is your philosophy, how you have switched from commie to anti-commie.
That's right, yeah, that's it.
And you never really suffered from the witch hunt, except in that one occasion when
Royal
Roads.
Right. Yes, and, A witch hunt in Canada was a very mild thing.
Could you understand how young students today might go Marxist?
Oh, yes, I can understand that. What I find pretty hard to take, though, is when you've had a record of the behavior of Marxists elsewhere, you know, whether it's in China or in the Soviet Union, or the failures in Cuba, when you convert a nation like Cuba, where they're nothing but gamblers and farmers, into a nation that has the highest percentage of people in the armed forces of any place in the Americas. I mean, that sort of thing is, you know, it really makes you fed up.
For political students, it's worth reading from left to right. It's as fun. Thanks for coming out this morning, Professor Ferns.
Thank you.
Best of luck with your book.
Thank you very much.
And I'll be back with the latest on whatever after the break. Just to keep you up to date on the latest in the labor problems in British Columbia, I don't know what the count is into this. It's not ready yet. There was a little bit of a conference by Mr. Bennett this morning, which we're going to give you as soon as the videotape is all set up. Because while I tried hard to ignore the whole labor crisis today and just let it simmer, I'm waiting for an okay. By the way, I might just mention for all of those who noticed that our Ron's man and his wife and children were in a serious accident yesterday, Ron, of course, being BCTV sportscaster, that Ron and his wife and one of the children is in the MSA hospital at Abbotsford in stable condition, and a six-year-old daughter has been transferred for intensive care to Royal Columbian Hospital in New Westminster. And of course, we send our best wishes to Mr. and Mrs. Mann and trust that everything goes okay for them. As of this moment, I have a couple of things to do. One, I've got to give you this clip on the Bennett Scrum. And two, I want to tell you something about a performance in Vancouver shortly. I'll take a break and give you all of my last little package after the break. The avenues of consultation haven't been decided yet in the crisis between Solidarity and Mr. Bennett, but of course we get snippets of action every day in the corridor scrums in Victoria. And just for the record this morning, after mention of taxis last night by Mr. Bennett, I want to show you the scrum this morning.
Sir, you're quoted last night as suggesting that there's going to have to be tax increases next year.
No, I don't think there'll be tax increases with SOCRED programs, but those who consult with us, who have advocated unlimited spending and unlimited pay increases, they're going to be given a chance to provide their consultation. And when they make their advocacy as an alternative to this government, I'm sure that they'll tell what tax increases they would impose to pay for the increased spending and program spending that they would be encouraging. On the contrary, it'll give the people a good chance to see the alternative to the social credit restraint program.
So in other words, you're saying, sir, that you don't expect tax increases next year?
That's up to the finance minister, but the restraint program that we now have in place, that's being reinforced so that we can now proceed with or continue with the downsizing of the provincial government by 25%, so that we can now proceed with what are limitations on public spending and wage increases that are in the government's legislation. We can now proceed with the positive side of our program, the international marketing and the additional attraction for investment and jobs to British Columbia based on exports.
Last year's restraint was 12.3% increase in the budget. Can we expect the same for the coming year?
Well, as you know, Charles, the increase in the budget, that's a very superficial assumption in the question. As you know, what that really shows is what we've been arguing against, and that is large-scale deficits. The $180 million for interest on the deficit of the previous year is between 2 and 3%. The acceleration of public work projects, drainage, diking, accelerated bridge construction, and highways, which was part of the election, accounts for about a further 5%. In real terms, the budget went up about 4%. Those who advocate deficit financing and increased debt have an example of what that does to the budget. And that's why we're fighting so hard to prevent increased deficits and debt that give those type of increases that would beg a question like that.
Mr. Bennett, I have...
One obvious assumption from my part is that Premier Bennett is firm on his present plans with some slight flexibility in education financing. Famous People Players are coming back on the 29th. Tony Parsons is going to do the 8:30 show at the QE Theatre, doing the monologue bit, and I'm going to do the first show at 5:30. You mustn't miss Famous People Players, my favorite group. I'll be back tomorrow, 9 a.m. precisely.
Got a whole lot of money that's ready to burn, so get those stakes up higher. There's 1,000 pretty women waiting out there. They're all living the devil may care, and I'm just a devil with love to spare. So
Viva Las Vegas, Viva Las Vegas.
How I wish that there were more than the 24 hours in the day. Even if there were 40 more, I wouldn't sleep a minute away. Oh, there's blackjack and poker and a roulette wheel, a fortune won and lost on every deal. All you need is strong heart and a nerve of steel.
Viva Las Vegas!
My chum Shrum on check at midnight.